out. Thanks for coming. What?
There are three of you.
Uh-huh. Good. Maybe I'll put...
You've got to work that into your lecture now.
Let me just see when I start. So I will talk about coloring problems for circles. And I will start with the occasion for this is a very remarkable development by Aubrey de Grey that about a rather famous problem that I will now describe. And this is a problem of understanding the chromatic number of the plane. And the chromatic number of the plane refers to the following graph. The vertices are the point in the plane. So vertices, point in RD, in R2. And the two points, and P and Q, are adjacent if P minus Q, the distance between P and Q, is equal to 1. So this is the unit distance graph on the points of the plane. And in 1950, Edward Nelson asked the question, what is the chromatic number of the plane? How many colors you need to color all the points of the plane so that points of distance 1 will be colored by different colors? And at that time, he was an undergraduate student. And he referred to it as some sort of a new four-color conjecture or four-color problem. Which was very nice, and indeed, this was draw attention, and it's a very exciting problem, and it was known that until 2 weeks ago that that this number is between 4 and 7, and I will tell you why. So to color the plane with 7 colors, you look at the hexagonal tiling of the plane. Appropriate hexagonal tiling and tile the color periodically by 7 colors. I will not demonstrate it. To show that you need 4 colors, there is the following a very nice construction known as the Moser spindle. And it's named after the brothers Leo and Willy Moser that studied this problem. So the Moser spindle, it goes like this. You look at this configuration. Okay, so just imagine that these are two equilateral triangles, and you see, and now you want to add another edge, which is this edge. So those are equilateral triangles, and the lengths are 1. This edge is larger than 1 as I draw it. But if you will move it together, then at some point, when there will be also crossing, this edge will be of distance 1. And then you will get this graph that you cannot color with 3 colors, because if you color this, this is 1, this should be, say, 2 and 3. This is 1 again, 2 and 3. And this should also be colored 1. And then when you put them together and this, then you cannot color this 4. Okay, and then Aubrey de Grey proved, Aubrey de Grey is not a professional mathematician, he studied computer science and then moved to biology. He's very famous for his research on aging and also a bit controversial about his blunt claims that aging is something that can be solved. And he has a research institute doing what?
to make people live
much longer, something order of magnitude older. And these claims are a bit controversial. In any case, his efforts may cause this conjecture not to short-live, and I will not describe to you his. So he gave a nice very nice construction, but to prove that it's not four colorable, you still need to use some computers, especially SAT solvers. And
he proved,
Aubrey de Grey found, showed that the chromatic number of the plane is greater or equal to 5. So he found the final.
There's a computer needed to verify an example that you can tell us clearly?
No, I can tell you, I will tell you an example, not some variants of it. And the computer needs to verify that this graph is not four colorable. There is some ongoing project, a collective effort to find more examples, perhaps even to give an example where you can demonstrate humanly that it's not four colorable. But I can tell you the very recent example from this project, which is the following. It used similar ideas of the first example, but where is it? So this example that I saw this morning by Tamash Hubai, do you know him?
Yeah.
Oh, you, yeah, okay. What? No, you know him, and here is his example. You look at the A, which is all the points of the form I times pi over 3, of a graph, of a unit distance graph that needs five colors. It's not the original graph, but it's something which and then J times arc cosinus. Yes, you can do. Yes, please go ahead.
By compactness, lower bound is always can always be found by finite examples. So it's not a coincidence. This is also in the original example was about 1700 vertices. I don't know about.
No, this has more vertices.
One more comment, I'm sorry.
It's a good comment.
We are very poor in methods for proving lower bounds and chromatic numbers. That's a sport we are really terrible at. So any lower bound or chromatic number of a graph is an achievement.
I agree. So, So I will maybe elaborate on both of Nati's comments in a bit later. But wait. Yeah. No. I belong to Z. Wait. J is in 0, 1, half, and 1, and K is in 0 and 1. Okay, you look at this set A, and now you look at unit vectors with angles from A. So this unit vectors is a set of 36 points. So you have 36 unit vectors, and let's call this set VA. And then you look at the Minkowski sum, VA plus VA plus VA. So you look at all these unit vectors, and you look at all the sums of three of them. So this gives you 36 to the cube points in the plane. And this is an example where the chromatic number is not 4. And this was verified by a set solver. But you see that this is a... This looks like a nice conceptual idea. Okay, so you see some idea here, yes.
Sure,
I
do.
Yes.
These seem to be living in R, not R2.
We said on the
circle. I should mention that, of course, the unit distance graph is also famous for other problems. There is a famous problem by Erdős from 1946 which asked Erdős conjectured that the number of edges, if you have n points in the plane, the number of unit distances is at most n to the 1, at most n to the 1 plus little of 1. This is a famous conjecture which is still open. The example which shows that there are a more than linear number of edges, you take the k by k grid or square root n by square root n grid and look at the most popular distance. and declare this distance to be 1. This will give you something like slightly more than n, n to the power 1 plus a constant divided by log log n. You can be tempted to think that this graph may have large chromatic number, because usually more edges, the harder it is to color it. But this particular graph is bipartite, so you need only 2 colors. But you see that this type of ideas are sort of, you need to add to the integer some additional algebraic numbers, and then to do some things, and then you get this example. Okay. So this is now, why is this a problem about coloring circuits? Because another way you can describe this problem is that, let's say, the finite version that, as Nati said, is equivalent to the general version. You have a collection of unit circles, or circles of radius 1/2, if you want to be very precise, and you describe the tangency graph. So two circles are adjacent if they are tangent, and then this is precisely the same problem as the unit distance graph. And this will be convenient for a generalization. So now I want to mention a few other so I should say that for most of this talk, when I refer to high-dimensional combinatorics, this is the high dimension is 2, which is already quite a high dimension. But I will mention maybe briefly things in even higher dimension. As you see, this can be defined in any dimension, chi of Rd, and we'll say some words about it. And now I want to mention some variants. So one thing we can ask, what about graphs where all the distances are all greater or equal to 1? So we again look at the unit graph distance, but now we look at the configuration of points that all the distances are greater or equal to 1, and these are called penny graphs. Penny graphs. And this is because you can realize them by a collection of 1 cent coins. And this is the cheapest way to realize them. And what?
Rupees,
yeah, okay. And these graphs, there is a simple example which is similar to Moser spindel. With certain vertices. Yeah, I draw it a little bit. Okay, so this is the idea. Okay, now you have to, okay, I should do it again.
Are all triangles here equilateral?
Yeah, they are all equilateral, as you can see. And so you just do something slightly bigger than the Moser spindle, then you can realize a graph with all the distances greater or equal to 1. You can actually realize, you can look at Wikipedia, there is a picture of this graph with actual pennies. And here the coloring number is 4. And every such graph can be colored with 4. One more? It's not a graph, yeah. I told Janos in advance that he's more suited to give this talk, and he should correct me.
So try to realize this point, then you will see one which is surrounded by 5.
Okay, never mind. Yeah, it's something like this shows that the chromatic number is 4. And the fact that you can do it with 4 colors is a consequence of the 4 color theorem, because if you have such a graph, here are the pennies. So it's not, this time it's non-overlapping circles. So this is the adjacent graph of non-overlapping circles. Then this is a planar graph. So by the 4 color theorem, you can color it with 4 colors. I don't know if for this particular graph there is a simpler proof, which does not use the 4 color theorem. But so this graph always has a vertex of degree 3. So,
degenerate.
Okay, so there is a very simple proof Okay, and now we can also talk about more or less the opposite situation. So let's call this number P of R2, and P of R2 is 4. This is the graph of non-overlapping unit circles, the graph which corresponds to the tangency graph of non-overlapping unit circles in the plane. And now we can also talk about the precisely dual situation that we have circles, that we have points, and we look at the unit distance graph, but we assume that all distances are smaller or equal to 1. So this is a graph of you have a finite configuration of points. The distance between every two of them is at most 1, and your graph is those pairs where the distance is 1. And these graphs are completely understood in the plane. For example, you can look at this pentagram. So here all the distances are 1, and all the other distances are smaller than 1. So this is an example of such a graph. Here the chromatic number, as you can see, is 3. This is another example. Of course, you can do pentagrams of higher order. And you can also add the tails. You can also add the edges like this. And there is a theorem which says that these are all these graphs. And from this it follows, and let's call it BF of R2, which is the largest chromatic number of such graphs. So this is 3. So these are all the maximal graph of maximal unit distance graph, and all the distances are at most 1. And all these graphs are 3 corrobal. And this is also a very nice version that also extends in higher dimension. And now I want to move to our next stage. So since why did I bother to formulate these questions in terms of circles? Because we can now, let's try to talk about circles of different, not about unit circles, but about circles of various radii. Oh, but before that, let me mention one nice problem by Moshe Rosenfeld, and he considered the graph, so the vertices are points in R2, and X and Y are connected, adjacent, if x minus y, the distance between x and y is an odd integer. So this has more edges than the unit distance graph because he added all the odd integers as edges, and it's an open problem if this graph has a finite chromatic number. Very nice open problem. If you assume that the colors, the points of each color are measurable, then you can use techniques either from ergodic theory or harmonic analysis to show that the chromatic number is infinite. But the general problem is open, and this is a very nice problem by Rosenfeld. Sorry? Yeah, because his all integers, even on the line, if you take the points are the integers, you get a complete graph, a very large complete graph, and then the problem is easier. Okay, so now let me try to. Yes. It depends how roughly is roughly, but I don't know precisely. Okay, so now let's talk a little bit. Okay, so this was the first part of the lecture about unit distance graph, and let's talk about circles of different radii. So we can start. We can ask all these questions again. Once I Yeah, there also. Once I was lecturing. Actually, the first year I taught here at the Hebrew University, I taught in some class for soldiers, and there was one of the soldiers was Chanich Toran. I don't know how it's called in English. He was in charge of the administration, and he gave me a chalk in the beginning of the lecture. I start talking. This chalk become smaller and smaller, and I got more and more nervous what we'll do in this. And then when it was really tiny, very tiny, he pulled out another chalk and gave me. So, okay, so now what happened when we have circles of different radii? So let's start with the question where we considered the tangency graph of non-overlapping circles of different radii. So this is let's say a finite number of circles. So this is an extension of something we considered before, and this graph is again a planar, so it's four colorable. And of course, the example that I showed, or the correct example, like the one I showed, showed that the number of colors is four. So the chromatic number is always four. But this is significant because this is precisely, this is the four color theorem. There is a famous theorem by Kebe, which is called the Kebe-Andreev-Selston theorem. Which shows that every planar graph can be realized in this manner. So in this case, the fact that such tangency graphs are four colorable is a very deep theorem. And I should say so the four color conjecture, of course, the prototype for coloring problems. Yes. They don't have to be equal. Yeah, not necessarily. You can also assume that they are really distinct, but not necessarily equal. Yeah. So this is the four-color theorem, and I should say one of the very central problems in combinatorics is to find out new proofs of the four-color theorem, and perhaps a more concept or conceptual understanding for it, and this is of course still a famous problem or a famous challenge. Okay, now we can talk about the other situation. Now, what happened if we have intersecting? So the dual situation, we have points of different sizes, but every two intersecting. Circles. So the study of intersecting circles of not necessarily the same radii is also a very exciting topic, and I will tell you things which are known. So result. So there is a result by several people. Maybe Janosch is one of them. No, Alon, Pach, Sharir, and Pinchasi, and last. Oh, you should. Okay, which says that the number of edges for the number of tangency for such a situation is at most 2n-2. So you are
it's small enough, now you can have one.
Yeah, so again, the graph is, the circles are not necessarily of the same size. Every two of them has a point in common, and the graph is those pairs which are tangent. Okay. And it turns out that the number of edges, so there is a result by Rom Pinchasi, which starts this which is a result of the a Galai-Sylvester type, which shows that in every such graph there is, when you have more than five circles, there is a circle which is tangent to at most two other circles. And this is a Pinchasi result, and then there is a subsequent result by Pinchasi, last, Sharir, Alon, maybe also Janosch. Yeah. It, okay, I didn't say it's true, I just say.
You need distance, there are more than.
It's an upper bound, so.
What?
Nothing.
Wait, so maybe.
What is this number 2a minus 2?
It's the maximum number of tangencies.
No, I think that any two of them have to intersect.
Any, yeah, yeah, this is what I said. Yeah. Any two of them have to intersect. You see,
and
intersecting.
The maximum number of
tangencies is 2n minus 2. And this also implies that.
And that is a theorem?
This is a theorem by Alon, Pinchasi, Last, and Sharir, and also maybe Janosch. What? Okay, sorry. So I will come to pseudo circle. But okay, so this is, it still follows from your theorem, and in any case, this line of research, there was an earlier paper of Pinchasi, which is Galai. You all remember the Galai Sylvester theorem, which says that every time we have a configuration of points in the plane, not all are on the same line. There is a line between precisely two. So this is sort of a theorem about minimal degree of some graph. And also here, the minimal degree is, I think it's two or three, maybe two, but you need to have at least four circles. And as Jano said, this extends to pseudo-circle, which I will mention in a minute. But now let's move to the cell type of question where we don't make any restriction, neither that there are no overlapping as here, or the intersection like this. So we can look about collection of circles, not necessarily of the same radius, and ask what can we say about the tangency graph. And here, there is some problem. So we need to define what is the tangency graph. So we consider two circles tangent only if they look like this. So here we don't consider this. This is a complete graph. But this causes a difficulty. So although this does not immediately give you large complete graph, if we this situation allow to build such graph, so if you have n circles, there are examples that the chromatic number is greater or equal to log n, and it can be shown that the chromatic number is at most log square n. So this example, it's not always the case, and this is always the case. So in particular, the chromatic number is not bounded. And this is something that we discussed with Rom Pinchasi some years ago, so I don't know if this is a common knowledge. But in any case, there is a famous conjecture, or not so famous conjecture, actually a Ringel conjecture, which says that if there is no more than two circles passing through a point, then the chromatic number is bounded. Yeah, so actually, I said it's not so famous because when at some point I wrote some survey which included this part, and then I came across this conjecture, and now I try to find more reference to it, and the only thing that Google showed me on Ringel conjecture was my paper. So this was a little bit frustrating. What? Yeah, this might be, yeah. Well, one reason for that, well, initially I discovered that I misspelled the name Ringel in my paper, so with the misspelling, it was certainly
unique.
Yeah. Okay. So this graph, the tangency graph of circle, is very interesting graph, and And as Yano said, we should move, from various reasons, we should move to pseudo-circle. I should say that there is a very nice question. What is the maximum number of edges? Okay, so... So, what, in Ringel conjecture, I don't know.
Do you know? Call it Ringel's circle problem, you get a lot of hits.
Ah, okay, Ringel's circle. Okay, so I will mention a variation of this conjecture in a minute, and I should say that we can ask what is the... Okay, so let me give you an example. Suppose you have a collection of points and lines. You see, this is points and these are lines which pass through them. And usually, so let's say we have n points, n lines. So altogether, we have n, order of magnitude n points and lines. And it's a famous question, what is the maximum number of incidences between points and line? There is a very crucial result by Trotter and Semeredi and Trotter, which says that the maximum number of incidences is at most n to the fourth third. Yeah? And, but you see that this can be regarded as a tangency graph because we can replace every point by a very small circle and we can press every line by a very, by part of a very, very large circle. And then the incidences will correspond to tangencies. So, right? So, from this example, there is a simple example which shows that you can have n to the fourth third incidences, again, based on the grid. So, from this example, you immediately see that you can find a tangency graph which where the number of edges is n to the fourth third. And it is a very deep open question that several people ask, I think Micha Sharir and Pinchasi and others, that in every, the tangency graph, so again, we need to assume something to avoid this situation. Tangency graph, let me move to pseudo lines and then this pseudo circles. So it's convenient what are pseudo circles? So pseudo circles are like circles, but usually when you refer to pseudo circles, also to pseudo lines, you don't refer to the individual but to the collective, and a collection of pseudo circles is a collection of closed simple curves like this, with the property that any two of them either disjoint or they cross in two points. So you can also have something like this. So here is a collection of four pseudo-circles. Let's not allow tangency because we can all... Yeah, so we don't allow tangency, and by not allowing tangency, we eliminate this problem. And then we can ask about, and then what is the incidence? So the two pseudo, whenever you have two pseudo circles, here is a, let's draw them like circles. So
in the case when you, on the left, mm-hmm. That is exactly Kober's theorem, right? Kober, that you can then map conformally to that. So then pseudo circles and circles are the same for that problem.
For that problem, for non-overlapping...
Any non-overlapping circles can be conformally mapped to round circles.
Yeah, I don't know if you can do it simultaneously for the entire... You can?
That's Kober's strongest theorem.
Stronger theorem. Or strongest. Yes. This is the strongest theorem Kober ever put. Okay, anyway. Yeah, I didn't know that. But
the Riemann mapping theorem, it all works. It's just for one circle.
But it's true for any configuration. I see, okay.
There's still an unsolved problem there that Schramm has a
world record on. Yeah, I remember. There is this conjecture that they proved for quantum Bilkin. Anyway, so if it's non-overlapping, then pseudo circles and circles give you the same graphs. Now, when you have two pseudo-circles that here I draw, which are almost almost perfect circles, then they determine something which is called the length. This is called the length. And, you know, you can also talk about these types of things which are called the lunes. So you have lens and lunes. And when we have pseudo-circle, we will say that two circles are adjacent if there is no other circle that intersects the lens between them. And this gives you a notion of adjacency, and this gives you graphs which are more general than the graphs that described by circles. And in particular, this 2n minus 2 result apparently is quite easy for circles, but it's a very deep result for pseudo circles. And so the adjacency graph for pseudo circles, yes. Yeah. No, this follow from the pseudo a collection of pseudo circles. Every two circles intersect, cross twice. Not at most. Twice. Yeah. Zero. Either they're disjoint or they're cosbound. This is, and usually when you talk pseudo line, pseudo circles, this is a topological condition on the entire configuration that they behave like circles. So it's not the individual property of the individual pseudo circle. Okay. So we see that the tangency graph is an extension of the incidence graph of points and lines. And there is a conjecture that the number of edges is at most n to the 4/3 times polylog n. And this is a very beautiful conjecture related to both to the incidence.
This applies now to
pseudo circles.
Pseudo circles with the notion of adjacency, what you said.
Yeah, No. The lens is empty. Yeah, the lens is private. And this conjecture is open. The best record is due to Adam Marcus and Gabor Tardosh, and it's n to the 3/2 times log n. And it uses a very, very beautiful mathematics. And the fact that you need the polylog n, so you need it's n to the 4/3 is not correct. This is a result by Micha Sharir, which shows also a very beautiful connection with the distinct problem of Erdős that was solved by Goose and Katz, and it shows that you have examples, distinct distances problem, and it shows that you have based on the on that configuration, show that you need the log n, because you can always look at configuration of circles, actual circles, which correspond to all the distances, and then look at the most popular distance and give this. Okay, so this is this is what I want to say in the plane. And now I want to briefly talk about a higher dimension. So, of course, all the question I mentioned. Okay, I should say there is another class of we talked about general circles. We talked about non-overlapping circles. We talked about pairwise intersecting circles. And we can talk about another thing which is interesting, and this is about covering circles. So about circles that either infinite family of circles that cover the entire plane, or we can look at a big rectangle and circles which cover. And there is a very interesting connection between packing problems and the covering problems. So this gives you another class of graphs which are of interest. And now let's move to Rn. So what about the chromatic number of Rn? So, or Rd, I don't know if I should use. Let's use t. We're used here. So this is greater or equal to a constant to the power of d. This was also an open problem for a while, and this was one of the consequences of very celebrated result in combinatorics, the Frankel-Wilson theorem. There is a conjecture by Alexander Seufer, which says, so his conjecture, I mention it because it's a very outrageous conjecture. It says that R, if you, RD is equal precisely 2 to the D plus 1 minus 1. So in particular, it gives the number 7 for the plane. And it gives this number. So it's very outrageous. I really like outrageous conjecture because some very rarely they are, I don't know if they are construction as far, I don't know. The outrageous conjectures are good because sometimes it's not so easy to disprove them, and very rarely they're even correct. But this is really a bit too much. What happened for the line? We will fix this, but okay, let's say D bigger than one. I'm not sure. I mean, but you see, this looks outrageous, but Janos mentioned the conjecture about the R dash. What's this? The with the convex combination. How it's called? About how many points are needed to have a convex n-gon. The Erde-Sekeres, for the Erde-Sekeres problem, there is a similar conjecture, also 2 to the d minus 1, and it looks similarly at outrageous. Although people believe...
Except that there is a construction.
but the conjecture, this is a precise number, looks similarly outrageous. So probably it's also false, but maybe it's true. In any case, so this is about this. Now we can talk about this B of RD. So this is a unit distance graphs when all the distances are at most one. So this is closely related to another well-known problem, which is the Borsuk conjecture, or Borsuk problem. There was a Borsuk conjecture was that this number is less or equal to d plus 1. And in fact, it was also a statement about not only about finite set, but about general sets. So b of rd is less or equal to d plus 1. I should say also equal to d plus 1. This statement says that every set of diameter 1 can be partitioned into sets of smaller diameter. And this is a similar statement, but only for finite sets. I should say that unlike the chromatic number, it's not known. It's not known what is the relation between the finite number and the general number. It's not known that they are the same, and probably they are not the same. In any case, this is false, and BF of RD, the R configuration of points in RD, so the distance of every two is a smaller or equal to 1, and the unit distance graph has chromatic number, some constant to the square root d. And it is a very interesting open problem to understand. So this is the result of Jeff Kahn and myself from 1993. It's so long time ago, so I can give credit without any bridge of modesty, because but in any case, this is, the main question, so it's a very interesting open question, what happened for C to the D. Now, I should say whether it's exponential or sub-exponential. And I should say a constant. Bigger than 1. Bigger than 1, yes. Well, I don't make conjecture. Yeah, so. What? The C was improved. The C, I think we proved 1.2 to the square root D, and it was improved to, 1.2.
Could you say, rough, just one word, what kind of configurations are?
Yeah, I can say one word. You start with the configuration which showed that the chromatic number of RD is exponential, and then you take this configuration and tensor it with itself. So this gives you a new configuration in square of the dimension, and it also have this exponential c to the d, but since this is square of the dimension, this have the effect of. So the constant was improved, but the square root d was not improved over the years, which, you know. Of course, I should say, I'm running. Okay, I should say that I moved very quickly from dimension 2 to asymptotic behavior when the dimension go to infinity, and I don't want to hint or to imply that intermediate dimensions are not interesting. In various problems, the most exciting dimension are some numbers which are neither go to infinity nor go to zero, but something like 24, 8, or some numbers like this. Let's mention it in a minute. I should say, okay, now what about the penny graph? So what about the penny graph of RD? So we look at a graph of spheres, this time of the same radius, unit spheres, which are non-overlapping, and every two of them are adjacent. And what can we say about such a graph? No, sorry. They're adjacent if they are tangent. Okay, so is it clear? So it's like the penny graph, the high dimensional penny graph in RD. What is the chromatic number? And this is is it exponential? Actually, I don't know an example where it's like. Let me tell you. So one question, in order for such a graph to have large chromatic number, it needs to have large minimum degree. So we can ask is the minimum degree of such graph? Or we can ask what is the minimum degree? What is the minimum degree of such graphs? And in particular, is the minimum degree exponential? Now, we know that if we have a unit sphere in RD, it can touch an exponentially many other unit spheres. But can we have many unit spheres that every one of them touch exponentially many others? So this is a nice question, right? And this was a question that was asked early on. And there is a paper by Nati and me that we studied it, and even we made a bold conjecture that the minimum degree must be sub-exponential. So, where is Nati? Ah, here. And I should say, why did we make the bold conjecture? Okay, so I'll tell you the story, but I will cheat a little bit, and then I will explain where I'm cheating. So, there is a famous question about what is the densest packing of spheres in RD, and essentially there is an example by Minkowski that the density is 1 over 2 to the n, and essentially nobody was able to improve this density substantially. And now we look, instead of RD, you can consider a situation where you have small balls packing balls of the same radius which pack a very large ball. And we ask what is the density. And one thing we can do, which is a finer statistic than density, is to look. Here I recycle some picture from Peter's talk. So you can ask what is the distance distribution. So you look at the distance, and you look how many pairs of radii are at this distance. So of course, when the distance is smaller than twice the radius of the small distance, you have zero. And then it go up, and let's put it on, we take the log of this number, divide by the dimension, we get a graph like this. And Nati and I, we showed that if the graph is smooth in near the place where it's stopped to be zero, then this implies that the Minkowski bound is the correct bound. Okay, so this is what we proved, but now I will explain what was the cheating here. So the first thing, we didn't prove it for sphere packing, but we proved it for binary codes. So this is, but then later people did it for sphere packing. The second cheating is that we didn't actually needed, we need much stronger thing than it's smooth here. We needed that in some short window, we will have, it will be below the graph of the extremal property, and then to get this conclusion. And the third cheating is that even at that time, we already knew that the result, the thing we wanted to prove is tight, the Gimel-Varsham bound, is not correct for large alphabet because of the algebraic geometry code. So we had good reason to suspect our own conjecture. In any case, soon afterwards, a few years later, people indeed verified that our conjecture in the original context is incorrect for the binary code. And also about 2 months ago, Sergei Vladut showed that there are lattice packing in space that the kissing number is exponential. And this is a very nice, and this, I think this is, the minimum degree is exponential. Of course, this is an infinite lattice, but you can always cut it somewhere, and then the minimum degree will not be exponential, but then you get rid of all the balls which have sub-exponential, and then you will be left with a graph of a tangency graph of balls with minimum degree exponential. So I think this result, I think it's exciting. I was excited, but it's also, it seems to suggest that that maybe algebraic geometry codes will eventually break all these Gilbert-Varshamov and Minkowski bounds and by some more cleverness. So, okay, so the last remark I wanted to mention is that this problem is already in the plane, can be asked also for the hyperbolic case, plane and space. And there, when we talk about the unit distance graph, it's important to ask what is the unit, because the graph is different for different units. And it's not known that the chromatic number is bounded uniformly for all units. And there is a result by Costa here? So Costa, Gulobev, and Evan Decorte had nice result about the chromatic number of such graphs when you assume again that the color classes are measurable. So let me finish here. Thank you.